So, hello everybody.
My name is Martin, and I am a software developer. I work in connected TV, so I do mainly application in C, JavaScript, and sometimes Objective-C for TV streaming video. But in my spare time, I like to mess up with hardware, so I had a few microcontroller projects, like timers, alarm clocks, and stuff to fix the house, improve the house, and stuff like that. So in this talk, I'm going to show you how to build, how I ended up building my own PCB at home. And it's not rocket science, so I don't know if there are any electrical engineers in the room, so maybe they are going to scream because I cannot solder properly or something like that. But I mean, it works and it can be fun. So I started with breadboard. I started electronics. I do not have at all an electrical engineer education. So I started with the internet and learning myself with breadboards. This is quite handy actually, because you can put your components wherever you want and you can see the result directly. Problems are it's quite fragile, so if you remove a wire, you don't know where to put it back. It takes space, of course, on your desk and can become very messy like here. And you cannot use SMT chips, so SMT is surface mount technology. So it's chips you put on one surface of the PCB of the board. And more of the chips are like that. So then I moved to the launchpad. The launchpad is a small eval board for the MSP430. It's a microcontroller made by Texas Instruments, which is very cheap, and I recommend everybody to use it because it has a nice and clean architecture. But then again, if you want to integrate everything and have a nice prototype, you are kind of stuck because you have a limited amount of shields. Sometimes the shields include some parts you do not want. It's pretty expensive. I mean, if you use Arduino, I don't know what the base price is, but it's $10 or $20 at least. And then you need to put the shields on top of that. It still takes place. And if you want to use SMT chips, you have to rely on some small adapters or things like that. So not very easy. I thought about having my PCB made outsourced in some professional company. So this is something I guess can be done. I did not try it because I was a bit afraid, or I don't know why actually. But then delays are long because you would have to make them in China or I don't know where. And then have them come back. You have minimum orders. So if you just want a small PCB like that, maybe it's not, maybe it's a bit overkill. So I ended up looking at doing the circuit boards myself, so I can iterate quickly, make one, two, three versions in the night if I want to. I can make the PCB the size I want using SMT components. And also one big argument was that it was a big opportunity to learn how to design a board myself. So if you look a bit on specialized blogs and everything, you have three main techniques. The first one I would like to try with a CNC machine. So CNC machine, it's a little machine that goes in two directions, and you can mill your board, just draw with a mill, I don't know how you say, a perceuse. So you and you can draw your board directly on the copper clad. I would like to try that, but it requires a CNC machine. Then you have the traditional technique with UV masks. So you put your copper clad under a UV light, and then you have some chemicals that remove a protective part, and then you remove everything, all the copper with a iron chloride, you know, it's a brown liquid. But I had some bad memories from technology class, basically. So I did not want to use that. So I ended up using the toner transfer method.
Question, for the CNC milling machine?
Yeah.
It drills through what?
Actually, I don't know if you know how a PCB is made. It's a epoxy, it's a layer of epoxy, it's basically plastic. On top of that, you have a layer of copper.
Right.
So if you just drill the copper to draw...
You drill the copper.
You drill the copper and you leave the plastic there.
Okay.
This way, you can basically draw whatever you want. Okay. And there are no chemicals at all. So toner transfer technique, I found that on some blogs again. It's pretty easy to do. You can do it with things you can find everywhere, basically in hardware shops like Castorama, Monsieur Bricolage. So this is the base PCB with plastic and copper here. You need some hydrochloric acid. This is acid chlorhydric. I never had any problem with it.
At quel niveau? Quel pH?
I think there's something written like 25%. It's 20-something. Actually, I have the bottle in my backpack. So I can later. So I always wear gloves and glasses, but I do it in a small basin in my kitchen. Never had any problem with it. This is hydrogen peroxide, so this is oxygené. You can find that in Castorama as well. This is a bit more expensive, but you can do plenty of both with just one bottle. Laminator, it's this thing here. It's a plastifuse. You know, you put your documents inside with a sheet of plastic, and it's going to put to glue the plastic to the document. Acetone and laser printer. So what you do is, I forgot, important step, you need a special paper, so a glossy paper. I use supermarket ads for that. It is the one you find that I use the Franprix one, but I guess I can do as well. It has to be very glossy, so the toner, you know, the toner is the ink from the laser printer, does not... go into the paper, but stays on the surface. We will see later why.
Can
we No, they were out of ads this morning. But basically, it's this kind of stuff here, you know, made in France, 1 euro, some 100% reduction, I don't know what. If you go to any Franprix, you can find some.
Oh, you mean the coupon?
It's a coupon, it's reductions, yes. And it's very shiny, very glossy.
So you lost the reduction?
Yes, it was for Camembert, visibly.
So you lost a euro?
Yes, but I won a nice PCB.
Bonsoir.
One important thing is not to forget the mirror option when you print your circuit. I did that a couple of times, so and I still do it. So once you have your circuit printed on the paper, you glue that to the copper board, so this is the copper board, and you feed it into the machine, like several times. This takes some time because these little machines here, they are regulated so that they do not burn, so the temperature does not go as high as possible. Something I want to do, and I've seen other people do, is remove the regulation. Like you open the machine, and you hack with the hardware to make it hit a bit more so that it goes faster. But then you burn yourself and the paper and everything. And once you get your board again, you will see the ink here. This is the toner. It has transferred directly into the copper. So you just remove the remaining paper, which you can throw away into the garbage. and you get a nice copper board with your circuit printed with a toner. And toner, the nice thing is that it will protect the copper from the chemical reaction that is going to happen afterwards. So when you put the board into the white mix of chemicals, you can see here the green. I think this is typical from copper. You know, when you see the roofs in Paris, you see some green. I think it's copper oxide or something like that. So all the copper which is not protected here goes away. And in the end, when you remove the ink with acetone, you get PCB, which is not very nice, but because here you can see some remaining ink, and sometimes you get some little artifacts, but it's perfectly functional. And the nice thing is that you can do quite a few SMT components with that. So everything SOIC works. SOIC is the package here. So this works perfectly. SSOP, some of them works. I won't guarantee 100% of them works, but most of them. I had success with most of them. And the nice thing with these SMT chips is that they are very, very easy to solder, actually. I was afraid at the beginning because you think, ah, it's small and I won't be able to do that. But it's much easier than the deep counterparts because you do not have to drill holes. So you save time here. And to solder them, you just flute them with solder and you remove the excess. So you solder all the pins at once. So this is quite handy. Other benefits from using your own PCB is that with some big areas like that, you can make custom touch sensors. You know, you just connect that to a microcontroller pin, and you have a lot of techniques to know if it is touch or not. You can integrate your board into a project or a prototype much easier because you can have mounting holes where you can put screws and stuff like that. You can put power supplies, like for an example here, I have an almost finished product which was a tea timer. Just, you know, to know when your tea is done or when the eggs are done. And it has a speakers because it makes a particular sound when the diner is ready. So for this project, I could put the power supply directly on the board, and it's very small. I could not do that with an Arduino or something else. That's basically it. If you want to get started, a few resources, like Eagle is the software I use always all the time to design my schematics and to do the board layout. It's quite handy, and best of all, it is free. Not open source, but free, and it's multi-platform, so you have it for Windows, Linux, everything. Component, you have DigiKey, which is wonderful. You can choose between too many references. I don't know how many, but it's maybe tens of thousands. It's sometimes a bit crazy, because when you're like me, you want to optimize everything, and you can't, because there are too many components, so you end up spending 2 hours for a single LED or something like that. I also put a French one here, which if you order online, actually, yeah, it's not very good, but they do.
C'est juste que le reste de 132. C'est juste ça.
Yeah, and shipping takes longer than DigiKey, which is abroad. So, but the nice thing is that they have a brick and mortar. They have a shop in Nation. So if you really need something during the weekend and you cannot wait 2 or 3 days, you can go to the shop and ask for.
Wow, right.
This is why I put it. Tutorials, I'm sure you know them already. You have Adafruit, Instructables, Arduino forums, everything. Two professional PCB services, if someone ever tried that, I'm interested to know if it works well. This one, OSH Park, is I think it is from SparkFun, and they do a batch orders of PCBs. So you group yourself with other people wanting some small amounts of PCB, and you get your PCB a few days later. and Seed Studio, I guess they are from China. And latest resources yourself, I hope I gave you some ideas how to start your little prototype. And it's not that complicated. So if you have any question.
Do you have an example
or something? Yes, but I'm a bit ashamed of it. You should not lose the saga and everything.
You seem to be saying that it's better to solder using that system than even if you were to use the CNC machine.
No, the important thing is that soldering SMT is much easier because you solder all the pins at once, and you have some chips, you know, some microcontrollers, they have some 48 pins. So if you have to solder them individually, this is a tea timer, so you have two
the
buttons to cook eggs, for an example.
Yeah.
You have a button minus and plus, so you set the time to 5 minutes or something like that. And when it's done, it screams the raving rabbit sound, you know, the raving rabbit. So I made a custom enclosure for that with two ears, and the two buttons are the eyes of the rabbit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How long did it take to design the board?
The design part with Eagle is actually quite long. I mean, I was a complete beginner, and it took me maybe, at least 5 or 6 evenings to get it complete. And it's not a very complicated schematic. So. I mean, for someone who knows CAD software and knows the basics, I guess it can be done much quicker.
Can you something like a Raspberry Pi, or is that too complicated?
Good question. The thing is, it's only single board PCB. So if you have complex layout and forget it. It's completely out of the question because BeagleBoard and the Raspberry Pi, and they use all BGA packages. So BGA packages, it's you have the chip, and you have some connection on the bottom of it. And you have maybe a 128 connection on the bottom of it. So it can never be done.
You can do an extension for Raspberry
Pi. Yeah, you can do an extension, or you can do a USB peripheral or stuff like that. Yeah.
Do you benchmark the two methods between ACIDs like you do and...
No, I have too much bad memories from technology class, so I didn't want to try that.
Ça, parce que tu dis d'un côté, il y a un produit, j'ai pas envie de le toucher, par contre, t'as pas de problème avec l'accepteur.
Mais c'est ça que le Rodrigue qui
touche ça. Yeah, yeah.
Ça, je comprends pas, en fait, pour moi, c'est pareil, face aux
dégueulasses. On est dans les mêmes camps, en fait, c'est dégueulasse.
It's all psychologic, I think.
Ok.
Ah bon, c'est ça, oui.
Well, I don't know any reason to not use iron oxide. I think it's perchlorure de fer.
Yes.
It's brown. It requires a UV insulation in insoles.
Mm-hmm.
UV light.
UV light.
Non, c'est pas insolé, c'est du perchlorure.
Bah, il faut que tu ramollisses ton truc.
En fait, tu dessines. Enfin, moi, je faisais ça avec un feutre.
Ah oui, où tu dessines, ouais. Sinon, tu as des trucs de cuivre spéciaux où tu as une couche photosensible sur le dessus.
Oui, c'est ça. Aussi, oui. Ça, c'est une
et tu passes aux UV.
C'est pas mal, ça.
Are you limited to single-layer PCs?
I guess so, yes. If you want to do... double layer, you have to really make sure the two layers align perfectly, and when you pass that through the machines, I don't know what the precision of that is. Maybe if you have some very big schematics and layouts, you know, but for something like SSOP, and if you want vias, you know, vias is when you make a hole inside the PCB and you connect the two layers one to the other, in order to do that, you have to have the two layers perfectly aligned, and I'm not sure this is doable.
I want to ask a question and also share some information with everybody. There's a Kickstarter project called Circuit Scribe, the scribe, Circuit Scribe, where you have a pen and you draw, you really draw like you write the lines you want, and it will connect.
Yes, but then where do you put the LED and the microcontroller?
Kickstarter Circuit Scribe.
Yes.
Circuit SCL.
Yeah. I mean,
it's really magic.
I do not. I mean, it's good for education.
But it's for education, right? It's for quick production.
If you want to really make a product with custom chips and stuff like that, it's a bit limited.
And my question then was, is there attempts to 3D print PCBs?
That would be the next question. Utiliser une imprimante 3D pour faire ton truc, parce que de toute façon, ça utilise à peu près le même mécanisme. C'est un peu une CNC en 3D.
Oui. I don't know if you can print metal, I guess, yes. Ok. If you have the link, put it in the comments of the meetup. Yeah.
I can see that you still have the wires, some wires, maybe because you couldn't have the right tracks.
Yes, basically I suck at layout, so this was a beta version, so this is not the final one, it's just a leftover I have from my house.
Are there software for automating layout creation?
Eagle does that with... some luck sometimes, and most of the time not so much luck. So automatic layout, from what I understand, is a complicated subject, and it's not working very well. And on this board, I also had to connect speakers, and speakers, they have wires. So the two of the wires are for speakers.
Quelle est la... Tu l'as essayé sous différentes températures pour voir comment est-ce que ça bouge un peu genre, tu laisses dehors pour la nuit pour voir si ça...
Le circuit
craqué. Non, le truc c'est que une des raisons pour lesquelles tu as des PCB qui sont plusieurs layers, tout ça, c'est que tu as envie qu'elles soient relativement contraintes dans la manière dont elles vont plier, la manière dont elles vont s'étendre sous certaines températures, se compriser, parce que le PCB et la partie de cuivre ne vont pas avoir le même coefficient de rétraction.
Alors ça dépend de ta plaque de base, donc, quelle que soit la technique que tu utilises.
Dans ton truc, tu essaies de mettre à des températures un peu bizarres pour voir si tu as des problèmes de connexion.
Non, j'en suis pas du tout à ce niveau-là. Mais bon, ça reste quand même... je dis qu'on peut faire du SMT, mais ça reste quand même des traces. Bon, on peut les voir à l'œil nu, c'est quand même assez gros. Hein. C'est pas non plus de la RF avec des fréquences de 1 GHz et compagnie. Je sais pas si j'y arriverai. Bon, déjà, au niveau du layout, il va y avoir des considérations au niveau de la longueur des pistes, des réflexions et tout ça. Donc, pour ce que je fais, c'est-à-dire de l'ordre du mégahertz à chaque fois, pas de problème.
Okay, one last question, maybe.
Thank you.